Abdaram, they say, whenever I leave the house, and on whatever thing my eyes fall on, Sabr. Allah Ta'ala says, Wallahu yuhibbu as-sabirin. Allah Ta'ala is lit for that in
school governing body of South Coast Madrasa.
Okay, assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. A'udhu billahi minash shaitani rajim. Bismillahir rahmanir rahim. Nahmatu wa nusalli ala rasulil karim. A very warm and generous welcome to all our guests here tonight. I think on a cold night like this, to brave the weather elements and to come out is a huge sign of interest, is a huge sign of commitment, and is a huge sign of dedication to the cause. You know, we gathered here today at the Apartheid Museum to launch Cage Africa, which is a branch of Cage UK. And you may wonder, if you haven't by now Googled Cage or understood what Cage stands for, by the time we finish tonight, you will know what Cage is about. So before I start, I just want to share some things with you. The word war on terror, renditions, Guantanamo Bay, arbitrary detention, torture, complicity, covert operations, terrorist policies. These are all synonymous, and they all have one thing in common, is they fight human freedom. These are the things that oppress people throughout the world, no matter where they come from. And Cage is an organization that fights for people's rights. I'm just going to share with you something of Cage's website in terms of their mission. Cage is an independent advocacy organization working to empower committed communities impacted by the war on terror. The organization highlights and campaigns against state policies, striving for a world free from oppression and injustice. And if you go to the website www.cageuk.com or www.cageafrica.com, you will get a lot of information on that. But before I call on my first speaker, I just want to share one little statistic with you. There were 775 detainees that were brought to Guantanamo Bay at the start of the war on terror. Right now, as of May 2014, there are still 149 detainees there that hasn't been charged. And I think Cage does enormous work in trying to help those that don't have a voice outside Guantanamo Bay. So to introduce Yusuf, Docrat. Yusuf is a board member of Cage Africa. I'll call Yusuf up and he'll share more light on the subject. Thank you.
Yes, assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. I firstly extend my gratitude, the organization's gratitude to our guests who've traveled a long, long distance to honor us with their presence. I also wish to extend my thanks to you as a community for coming out on, as Ibrahim has said, a very cold evening. And I thought I'd share just a few thoughts with you. I have just only 5 minutes, I'm told. So very briefly, let me start by saying that when an organization is launched, there is generally a sense of excitement, almost a celebratory tone about it. And I wondered whether we'd have that same sense this evening. But of course, when you think of the nature of this organization, it yields the very opposite feeling. Because launching an organization such as Cage Prisoners, Cage Africa, as we know, is testament to the fact that there is something seriously wrong with the world. So it's not a moment of joy. It's a moment of commitment. It's a moment of sober reflection to understand that there is something rotten and that rot is spreading and someone needs to resist. So I thought I'd share two issues with you. The first is the importance of speaking. as a form of protest. Some of you may be familiar with an author from Nigeria, a female author called Chimamanda Adichie. She's become very popular in the last year or so, and unsurprisingly. But she speaks about the notion of the single story, the single story that is told by the ruler, the single story that is told by the imperialist nation that seeks to define who you are, that creates the prism from which you understand the world. And we know who the ruling parties of the world are. We know the alliance of evil. We know the hegemony that they exercise over the world. We know the prism, we know the paradigm. And it is vital that people all over the world begin to challenge that prism, begin to challenge that paradigm and that single story that they create, because what they do is define who you are. What they do is tell you what to apologize for. What they do is tell you what to believe and what not to believe. And if we, as a society, in the southern tip of Africa, as a continent, and as a world, allow this single story to continue unabated, then we will have to answer not only to our children and to our grandchildren, but on the day of reckoning, we will have to answer as to why we did not change that story. And that brings me to the question of relevance then, because the one question you may be asking is, well, you're on the southern tip of Africa. You're in a country that is known for remarkable freedoms. There is general peace, political goodwill. What are you about? And why are you forming Cage Africa? And it just so happens, and if you have been following the news, you would have seen that the African continent is not immune to the imperialist endeavor. Now, the African continent is not immune to the war of terror against Muslims. The African continent is not immune to the war of terror against those who seek an alternative voice. And you will have noted that a group called AFRICOM, which really pursues the interests of the United States of America, is very much a partner of the African continent. There's talk of bases being started in our neighboring countries. And so very soon, we will be feeling firsthand the practical effects of renditions, the practical effects of black sites. And it is therefore very important that we start early, be alert, understand that we are not in a bubble. We are located within a world in which the United States of America and its allies have completely destroyed the fundamental cause of humanity. And we need to start fighting that. And on this issue of fighting, it is about submission. Because what they seek is for you to submit to their prism. And I just thought, because these things are available these days, I would type in the word prison in an English translation of the Quran before I started. In fact, Brother Feroz was kind enough to point it out to me. And I just want to read to you the translation of the one ayah that popped up, and maybe you can see why it's so important for us. And this is the ayah 29 in a surah called Al-Shu'ara, where the Quran is describing the conversation between Pharaoh and Musa alayhi salam, Moses. And Pharaoh says to Musa, if thou dost put forward any god other than me, I will certainly put thee in prison. So right from those times, you had forces who through their arrogance sought your submission. And if you did not submit, you would be imprisoned. And how different is a Barack Obama to a Fir'aun? How different is a British government to a Fir'aun? And this is the question that we have to keep asking us. Are we going to submit to them, or are we the people who have already submitted to Allah, to truth, to God? Are we going to submit to imperialism, or are we going to submit to our obligation to be just and to fight for justice? So may I, in conclusion then, say to you that we are really, really grateful that you are here. I pray, inshallah, that our guests will share wonderful words of wisdom which they have in the past, and I hope they will continue to do so. I hope that you will be encouraged to assist the brothers and sisters all over the world, not just in Guantanamo, but there are sites all over the world where brothers and sisters are being held, are being tortured, are being dehumanized. May Allah grant them success. May grant this organization success. And Jazakallah khair. Thank you.
Ameen. Jazakallah, Yusuf. You know, those 775 combatants, a lot of them have been released, barring the 149 that are still sitting in Guantanamo. How many have been charged with any crime? And I think that's an exercise for you to do when you go back tonight, and you can ask Google that question. And hopefully Wikipedia will give you the answer. But you've got to understand that what CAGE does is extremely, extremely beneficial to very, very large numbers of people. Each of those people that have been detained have families, have extended families, have children. And who looks after them when they have been incarcerated? And I think CAGE fulfills that role. Amandla Johnson. Amandla is from CAGE UK. He is the communications officer. He's been dealing with all aspects of media regarding to CAGE. He has also worked at Islam Channel and is The Guardian. And in addition, he works for various publishing houses. So I'm going to call him in. He's come all the way from the UK to share some background into CAGE. Jazakallah.
Thank you very much. The very very nice introduction. I'm very humbled to be here today with you all. Not just my first time in not just South Africa, but the African continent as well. So this is my first time on the African continent. And for someone who comes from an African diaspora community, my parents are from the Caribbean, Trinidad and Tobago, to be precise. It's quite enchanting to be here. So a little bit about CAGE. CAGE was founded around 10 years ago in response to the fact that many families in a part of London realized their sons, their loved ones, had been taken away to a hideous place in the Caribbean, not on a beach or somewhere nice, but in the prison cells of Guantanamo on Cuba. CAGE went to those families and drew up a list of names of the individuals that were taken there. And this became the first authoritative list of people who were held at what we later knew as Guantanamo Bay. And this was about 300 people they were able to identify. Now, we have to realize at this time, back in 2003, 2004, most of us had no doubt that these people were guilty terrorists. The narrative at that time was that these people had been in Afghanistan, they were a part of Al-Qaeda, you know, they'd done wrong and they should be locked up. But look where we are now. You know, look where we are now. Look how the narrative has changed completely. This is why the importance of organizations like CAGE is really paramount, because by raising awareness and showing, you know, the facts on the ground of these people, we've been able to show that these people have never been charged, for example. Sorry, I gave away the answer to the question that was put to you before. We've also been able to see that many of these people were picked up by mistake. They were tortured, they were abused. Muazzam Beg, who is a spokesperson for CAGE, who is now incarcerated in the UK as well. I mean, these people are the most interrogated people on the face of the earth. Maybe they've been interrogated hundreds of times. I'll leave it to our guest next to explain a bit more. But by raising awareness of these issues, we also raised awareness of the nature of America, of Britain, of countries who time and time again lecture us condescendingly about their values and about what they can bring to the world: democracy, freedom, liberty, all of these things. And what we actually revealed was that these countries have been part and parcel of a global web of abuse. And unfortunately, this web of abuse has taken in some countries on the African continent as well. which is obviously one of the reasons why we have set up, whether it be in Kenya, whether it be in Ethiopia, or whether it be in Mali as well. African countries, unfortunately, are also complicit in this. To give you some more information, CAGE was the first organization, actually, to discover around 100 black sites across the world, in places such as Poland, as far away as Thailand, and also in Africa as well. We're also the first organization to shine a light on British complicity in torture, so British secret services helping other countries, America especially, in the torture, rendition, the kidnapping and abuse of people around the world. One of the things we do is to highlight these abuses in the media. And in the last year alone, we've had about 6 or 7 front page stories on the lead in British papers. I think there's only one leading paper in Britain we haven't had a front page on. So we're really leading the way here in terms of explaining to people what is taking place across the world, in countries, in places people do not know about. At the center of our work is our connection to the community, to the victims, to the survivors and the people on the ground. And this is central to our success. We have a very strong connection with the Muslim community in the UK, so much so that people call us maybe from prisons across the world and say, "Cage, you're the only people that can help me." They give us a statement and we try our best to try and maybe find legal advice or something else, some other way we can help as well. I'll just illustrate to you the nature of what we're facing when it comes to the war on terror. And one of the cases that CAGE has helped to really promote in the media and to generate awareness. I don't want to steal Yvonne's thunder here, but we spoke earlier on, she mentioned the South African Bill of Rights. And one of the rights enshrined in that document is the right to not have your citizenship taken away. Now, a young man of Somali heritage in the UK, a British citizen, he was harassed by the security services in the UK. So much so that he decided to get up and leave the country because they were telling him, "You have to work for us, otherwise we're going to make your life a misery." So he left and went to Somalia, where he got married and started a family and stuff. But when he left for Somalia, the British government took away his citizenship. Now, the taking away of citizenship isn't necessarily just the case that they take away your passport, you can't travel. This basically means that you have no sort of international identity. Your rights, your international rights are basically taken away and you can be abused. I'll give you an example of this. Two Britons traveled to Somalia and had their citizenships taken away. They were later killed by American drone strikes. So this is actually quite a grave thing that can happen to someone. This young man was then snatched from Somalia, taken to Djibouti, and from there, he was then rendered, kidnapped by Americans, and taken to the States, where he is now waiting for trial. So we have a global web of abuse taking place, and hopefully, inshallah, by us having a presence on the continent, we can uncover some more of these abuses and shine a light on them. I want to end just by talking a little bit about Muazzam Beg. I'm sure many of you know Muazzam Beg, one of the few former Guantanamo detainees to write about his experience. And we're very fortunate to have another one with us today. Muazzam Beg, as I said, is one of the most interrogated men in the world, but yet the British government had the audacity to try and take him in and to try and accuse him of involvement in, they say terrorism and all this sort of stuff. We have to understand that Muazzam Beg was one of the few people on the face of the earth that was willing to speak out against the abuses, against the governments. He was fearless in his speaking out, and he would not, he would not mince his words, as we say in the UK. For this reason, this landed him in trouble, and so we await his trial next month. To give you an idea of the attempts by the British government to shut him up, they've told every newspaper in the UK that they cannot report on anything to do with Muazzam Beg at the moment. So Muazzam Beg was denied bail. Newspapers weren't even allowed to report that actually took place. They've tried so hard to shut him up. And so I make an appeal really to South Africans here, that when that trial comes up, I encourage you to really come together in solidarity and with the cause of Muazzam Beg. I saw, you know, there were pickets, there were marches outside the embassy. We need to really, really gather a storm so that the British government can see that this is someone with an important international message and someone who is important in South Africa, a country that has fought for justice, as well as in the UK, and that we will not take it as a community, them trying to silence us. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Amandla. While I'm also at that, just to share with you, normally at events like these, we say to switch your phones off. But I think tonight you can tweet about Cage Africa's launch. Hashtag Cage Africa, so you know, Facebook, WhatsApp, Twitter, please go for it. I now come on to the second last session on the program. I want to introduce you to Yvonne RIdley. Yvonne is a British journalist, war correspondent, and activist on the board of Cage UK. She writes several issues relating to Islam and politics today and travels the world campaigning and fundraising for causes from Gaza to justice for Afia Siddiqui. There's also a very interesting thread between Yvonne and our next guest, and we'll reveal that for you much later. So Yvonne, thank you.
Brothers, sisters, comrades, salam alaikum. This is the first time, I'm probably going to steal your thunder now, but this is the first time I've shared a platform with Mullah Zaeef. More than 13 years ago, I was one of thousands of journalists who sat at a press conference in Islamabad while he delivered a press statement on behalf of the Taliban. I never once could have imagined that 13 years later we would be sharing the same platform and I would be looking at him as my brother in Islam. So it's a great honor for me to be sharing such a wonderful platform tonight. Walking through the Apartheid Museum was quite an emotional journey for me tonight, because not only did it show me how far South Africa has progressed, but it also revealed to me just how Britain and other parts of the West have gone backwards. And Amandla made a reference to the South African Bill of Rights. But walking around just reminded me of the greatness of the common man and woman, and how ordinary people, when they're required to step up to the plate, can actually make great changes just through simple acts of resistance coming together in the face of some of the most powerful political forces on the planet. And it is in that spirit that we have come together tonight for the launch of South Africa's Cage chapter. I can't think of a more ideal place than South Africa, a beacon, a real beacon of international human rights. You know, this is so appropriate, and the venue itself is so appropriate. Amandla's already made reference to the line in the South African Bill of Rights, which says everyone has the right to citizenship and may not be deprived of citizenship. And yet there are nearly 50 people living in the UK at the moment who once held British citizenship but have had that removed by the current UK government. And there are already moves now to tighten up these laws and regulations. And it reminds me that while Britain and America have gone overseas to carpet bomb countries into submission in the name of democracy, back home they have been carpet bombing our very own freedoms and liberties. One of the other things in the South African Bill of Rights is that everyone has the right to freedom of movement. And you know, that's something that you probably take for granted these days. But there are people living in Britain today who, because of the war on terror, cannot leave their home. They are under a form of house arrest or detention. And while the British government made much of the situation of the Burmese leader Aung San Suu Kyi, about her being under house arrest, there are people in Britain who are under house arrest, people who cannot leave their home, and if they can, it may be for an hour. There are others who are under control orders, they call them TPIMs now, and this government and even the shadow parties are saying that they want to tighten up these controls. So while you in South Africa are enjoying hard-won freedoms and liberties, I want you to remember your friends in America and Britain and elsewhere in Europe who are seeing their freedoms and liberties reduced by the day. Still under this endless war called the War on Terror. I also saw another section which said in 1963 the South African government passed a law permitting 90 days detention without trial. We haven't quite reached that stage in Britain yet, but it's getting there. And of course, Amandla's already made reference to Guantanamo and the many, many grey sites, hidden prisons around the world where people are being held without charge, without trial. And there was one of the posters that I saw on the wall, and it was a biblical quote, and it said, "Remember those in prison as if you were in prison with them, and those who are tortured as if you shared one body," which is very similar to the Islamic saying that if that the ummah is like a body, and if part of that body is in pain, then we should all feel that pain. And at the moment, I think that we all feel the pain of what is happening around the world today. So it's so important, and the brother was right in his opening speech, this isn't a cause for celebration. In some ways, it's quite sad.
To introduce Sheikh Abdus Salaam Zaeef is an absolute honor. Sheikh Abdus Salaam Zaeef was born in Kandahar in Afghanistan. He was the ambassador to Pakistan during the US invasion of Afghanistan. He was detained. In effect, he was sold to his American captors. He spent time at the prison in Bahrain, and then he was also sent to Guantanamo Bay. The United Nations removed him from the list of terrorists in July 2010, again without charging him. So it is with great honor I call upon Sheikh Abdus Salaam Zaeef to address you.
Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Brother and sister, I think our brother and sister, they talk about Guantanamo Bay, and they talk about prison, they talk about the cage prisoner. Association. Just I want to talk a little far from that. I think the world wants peace. The people want peace. And the Muslims want peace. And I would say Afghanistan want peace. The peace and stability, this is our desire. Really, I was very young. I was in Afghanistan. I'm not remember the time, what kind of Afghanistan was in the peace time. Just during Taliban time, 5 years or 4 years, we saw the majority of Afghanistan stable. But still there was a problem in the north. But the completely Afghanistan, entire Afghanistan, I didn't see. We want to see Afghanistan. The stability in peace, I think, why this is not coming? What is the real reason? I think, by my understanding, this is something going on which the people, they are not satisfied with them. Or the people, they are humiliated. Or the people, they are deprived from their right. I think when I was very young, that Afghanistan was stable. And the king of Afghanistan, and all after that, the president of Afghanistan, he was moving along. He was drawing along. He was going in the city alone. And no bodyguard, no guard, no anyone was with him. And that night in Kabul city, he was going to Kandahar, he was going to Herat, he was going to Mazar, anywhere. Stable Afghanistan, the people, they were happy. We never see the weapons, we didn't see anything else. The people and the country was, the people was happy, the country was stable. And that time, the Russian, they came to Afghanistan, they invaded to Afghanistan. What was the reason of them? They wanted to go to the warm water of Khalij, and they wanted to occupy Afghanistan. And they came with 110,000 soldiers, with 4,000 tanks, with 1,000 aircraft, and with the big weapons. They came to Afghanistan. In the beginning, when they brought the revolution of Afghanistan, and they caught 60,000 Islamic scholar, tribe elder, and important people, and they killed them all in one day. 60,000 people. My relative was there. And still we don't know where they are, what happened to them. Just we find after the occupation, some grave in the area, there were 1,100 people were buried there. And nobody knows who they are because the land was ate them. Just the bone was remained there. And what will be the reaction of the people? For the father, for the uncle, for the elder, for the Islamic scholar. They started jihad against Russia. Afghanistan didn't stable after that. When the jihad finished, unfortunately, the Mujahideen was succeeded in the mission. But the problem came in Pakistan, in Iran, and they were supporting different Mujahideen leader. In Pakistan, 8 leader. In Iran, 7 leader. 15 leader for one presidential house. When they came to Afghanistan, they became united. Anyone was with arm, they had a party, they have a soldier, they have Mujahideen, they're starting fighting each other. Until the Afghanistan was destroyed, the Kabul was destroyed, and the people disappointed from that. The Taliban arrived, they tried 5, 6, 7 years. But the problem came, the United States, they came to Afghanistan, this fighting starting again till today. I think we didn't do anything. We didn't do anything against Russia. Even after that, we didn't do it. We didn't try for revenge. They killed over 3 million people. 3 million people they killed. Still, we have 1.5 million injured in Afghanistan. The orphans, the widows, they are. We didn't try because we wanted the occupation finished. We want stability of the country to remain, to enjoy the life. But the other problem came. And we didn't go to America. Still, I didn't see America. We didn't do anything. They didn't charge anything against any Afghan. The issue of Al-Qaeda was raised in Afghanistan. We wanted to resolve this problem with them. We had 3 proposals for that. When I was in Islamabad, I was talking with the American authority, with the embassy, with some high authority people. We had 3 proposals to resolve the problem. But we wanted the dignity of Afghanistan too. They were not accepting. They wanted he will be surrendered or will be killed. And they will allow to the American to go to Afghanistan, to search Afghanistan, to do that and to do that. Eventually, they came to Afghanistan. September 11 happened. I don't know who did that. Still, it is not known who was behind that. And what was this problem happened to the United States? I think I don't want to talk a lot, but the problem is non-justice in the world. The problem is non-justice. The justice, it is very important. If the people accepted justice, there will be no problem, I'm sure. But the justice win to respect the other country, to respect the other person, to respect the other community, and to understand the right of the people, and to keep the dignity of the people, and to keep ourselves convinced by what is your right. This is the big problem. I don't think we will see the justice. Because if the justice is coming, yes, the people are calling for the justice. The power countries, they are calling for the justice. But if they be convinced with the justice, if they say yes, justice for anyone, for all nation, for all country, they cannot go, they're able to go to the other country. They cannot be able to force the people to do what they want. They cannot be able to go to search the resource of other. They cannot be able to occupy the other countries. This is the big problem for the justice. I think the cage prisoner and our brother here, all they want justice. We don't want anything from America, from United Kingdom, from Europe, from anyone else. We wanted justice. And please to be kind with us. And bring our people to the justice. This is Zulam. Until this Zulam is continuing in the world, till the justice is not coming to the world, then this problem will be continuing. The world will be not stable, never. One day, fire will be starting from one area, tomorrow will be starting from other area, after tomorrow will be starting from other area. Because the people, they are not able to bear what some people wanted. Why? Why I will be obeying to you? Why I will be surrendering to you? Why I will give my right to you? Why I will accept what do you want? And why my country will be occupied by you? Why my leadership or some people, some authority will be buying by you to use against me? This is the big problem. And I ask from my brother and sister, they have to know that and have to do struggle for that and peacefully struggle for that. And I think the reason of the cage prisoner today, this is just this purpose, justice for the people, justice for the Chinese. In this problem, we knew that this will be increased because the fighting increasing, the problem increasing, they will be capturing the people, they will be arresting the people, but to be justice. We don't I'm not the person to defend from the crime. The crime we don't want. Islam not defending from the crime. But anything they have the way to be survived. I think anything will be survived by justice. We want justice. And our brother, they are in Guantanamo, they are in Afghanistan, they are in the other prison, they are here in the South Africa, they are in the other jail in Arab countries in very bad condition. And we have to do and help them. If we cannot able to do anything to arise, the voice, to raise the voice and condemn that. Because the Rasul Akram sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says, وَمَنْ لَمْ يَهْتَمَّ بِأَمْرُ الْمُؤْمِنِينَ فَلَيْسَ مِنَّهُ. And the people, when the mu'minin, they are not care about the problem of other mu'minin in the world. Rasul Akram sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says, they are not from us. And we are from Rasul Akram sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. We want to stay with them. And for at least we can do that to call for justice and to do what we can do that. And also we want from South Africa and from other countries to help us for justice. And this is the only way to survive the world and survive the nation and to bring peace and stability to any country, to any nation. Thank you for listening. This was my humble request for the brother. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullah wa barakatuh.
JazakAllah, Sheikh Zaeef. I think I just got a little anecdote to share about Sheikh Zaeef. When he was arrested and he made dua to the Almighty, he said, it wasn't about release me from Guantanamo. It was about do what is right. If you believe I deserve to stay here, then I will stay here. And if you believe I need to be released, then the Almighty will make that right decision. And I think the people that have had the opportunity to spend some time with Sheikh has been extremely impressed with his spirituality, his humbleness, and his humility. If you just consider what he went through in terms of the torture and the arrests and the interrogations and the detentions, you can't fathom how would somebody be so humble and humble and have so much humility when they release. So Sheikh, shukran jazilan, thank you very much. The voice of the voiceless. You know, we're getting to an Orwellian society. Just today at 3 p.m., the British have raised the terror threat to severe because of what's happening in Iraq and Syria. I don't know when last anybody looked at the globe. I mean, look, the Americans don't know where the different countries are, but if you look at where Syria and Iraq is and where the UK is, it's very unlikely you're going to get something landing in the UK if it's fired in Syria. But again, you've got to understand that they try and keep the psyche of the people up. It's that fear. I mean, cage is a huge threat to the government. They closed their bank accounts. They froze their assets. They made people boycott their sponsors. It is speaking up for justice. And like Sheikh Zaeef said, it's all about justice. Cage Africa is for justice. جنة ونعيما صلوا عليه وسلموا تسليما حتى تنالوا جنة ونعيما صلوا عليه وسلموا تسليما حتى تنالوا جنة ونعيما صلوا عليه وسلموا تسليما حتى تنالوا جنة ونعيما صلوا عليه